What did Tom tell you that we were going to do today?
Well, talk about our growing up in Germany during World War II and subsequent years. So
here we are.
Yeah, here we are.
When you look at some of those pictures over there on the wall of Nuremberg, what's your reaction? What do you think there when you look at some of the devastation?
Well, that's just the way it looked like at that time. And mostly immediately after the bombing, like the second picture and the third picture with the advertising, we call it Litfaßsäule, you know, where they put advertising on. That was after the bombing when people started to clear up, to clear the roads and so on. And also what they did, all the bricks, they cleaned them up to for starting rebuilding already, yeah. You know, and that was just after the bombing raids.
Where were you born?
I was born in Krefeld Hills, which is a small town, actually, a suburb of Krefeld now. It's right between the Rhine River and the Dutch border in the lower Rhine region. So I would say maybe about 20 miles of each side, right in the center.
And you were born when? What year?
February 10, 1931.
Now, did you have any brothers or sisters?
I had one brother. One sister, the oldest one, but she passed away as a infant.
Okay. And you had a brother?
And then I had one older brother, yes.
And how, was he older?
Yeah, he was born in 29.
Okay. What'd your dad do for a living?
Well, when I start thinking of it, what I remember as a little kid, he started out as a farmhand, I mean, in my time, you know, prior to that, I think he was a coal miner in the Ruhr Pocket. That's where he was born, in Dortmund. But what I remember, we lived in hills, in the countryside, in a home that was furnished by the farmer that my mother and father worked for, like a peasant type, you know. And so he was a farmhand at that time until we moved to a different town, to St. Tönes, where my wife was born, and also in a countryside, and the same situation. We had a house given to us or rented to us by the farmer, and my dad and my mom too, they worked on the farms. But then in 1936, you know, Hitler was bringing up the economy and so forth. My father had a chance to take a course as an arc welder, electro arc welder. And that was in Krefeld-Uerdingen, which is right on the Rhine River. And he started, after the course, working at the Uerdinger Waggon Fabrik. That means the factory was making railroad cars. You know, there was a lot of welding involved and so forth. And from that time up, you know, we kind of lived better from day to day and year to year. And, I don't know. But at that time, you know, we were all happy that it was a depression at that time, that was getting over and people were getting more work and living better and so forth, thanks to Adolf Hitler. Mm-hmm. But we didn't know what he had in the back of his mind. Sure. And that showed in later years.
What was was there politics talked about in your house? Did your mom and dad talk about it?
Well, my dad and two other neighbors, one of them was a worker like my dad, and the other one, he was a very strong, shall I say, Nazi. I kind of hate the word, but he was a National Socialist, which is...
Nazi's, yeah, fine.
Nazi. And every Saturday night, they played cards. And I remember the room full of smoke, secondhand smoke, didn't bother me. full of smoke, and later, you know, maybe they had a few beers or so, I don't know. This Carl Ritten was his name, and the other one, Gerhard Ritten, that was his brother, he was a laborer. But Carl Ritten, he ran the post office, and he was very, very politically involved. He was a brown shirt, you know, he wore that very proudly. But to give him credit, that in 1944, in the late fall of 1944, and he must have been in his early 50s, that he volunteered and, you know, got killed in action on the Eastern Front.
Mm-hmm.
So he... yeah, you know, things like that. But that was the only politic that I remember in my younger years. And my dad always told me, even later on, he said, never argue about politics and religion, because some of the wisest men in the world get nuts over it.
Yeah.
They couldn't handle it, or they couldn't come to a conclusion or whatever. But, and I think that was a wise statement.
Now, your dad at some point, I'll show you the picture, became part of the Navy.
Yes, but that was way back in 1943. He was 38 years old when he got drafted.
Mm-hmm.
And he was stationed in Belgium, and he had his training there. And then he was stationed in on the North Sea in Germany on a mine, was it mine seeker, or, you know, was it to clear the mines that the British had dropped. And but then he ran out of fuel. And he was deployed with a company that took all the landlines down, the electrical lines, the copper lines, and replaced them with aluminum because they needed the copper for the shell cases or for wires or whatever. So that was his last station as a soldier. And that's when he was captured, I think, by the English or the Canadians in northeastern Germany.
This would have been 1945?
Yes.
Yeah.
When he got taken prisoner.
Right. Was that about towards the end of the war at that point?
Yes.
Did he ever talk about his Admiral Karl Dönitz?
No. My dad always, you know, he did what he had to do, like thousands or millions of German people. If you didn't do them, you were shot. You know, I mean, you had no choice. So he never talked much about politics or, you know, his leaders.
So as you were growing up, in your early days, you could see your standard of living was improving.
Yes.
Under Hitler, so therefore, I mean, everybody kind of felt good about
the state of
economy.
Yes.
At some point, what was your schooling? Where did you go to school?
Well, in St. Tönis, you know, we lived a little outside. I had to walk about a mile and a half, sometimes in wooden shoes. I know I told my kids that years ago. You know, in wintertime we had wooden shoes with a little straw in to keep it warm. And, well, You know, they mocked me. But that's what I did. And I didn't mind. I mean, that was a way of living. But the schooling I had was the regular 8 years. 8 years from, you started school with the age of six. And if your parents had money to send you to the gymnasium or middle school, and your grades were good, fine. But if your parents didn't have the money, you just finished your normal schooling of 8 years, and then you had a choice of learning a trade. Now, I always wanted to be a blacksmith after school, but there was no opening, and my dad was, in the service, and my mom didn't know much about this, and she didn't have much time because she was working. I ended up being an apprentice for an electrical installation business, and I served an apprenticeship of 4 years, from 1945 to 1949. I made my journeyman. And there was also some plumbing involved, so. But when I was 18 years old, for my journeyman work assignment, I had to install a newly built carpenter shop with all the equipment, electrical, switchboards, and the whole works. I had my blueprints, and I remember my master. He was a son of a gun, but that's what I thought at the time. But he was good. I laid the main, the main line coming in, the electrical line to the board, to the switchboard, and he didn't say anything while I was doing it, and I had plenty of time, but. When I said I was all done, everything was running, and then he came in, and the first thing he said, he stood at the doorway, and that was the main line, and there was a drop of maybe an inch and a half, 2 inches, on about a 80 feet supply line. He said, "What is this? What did you do there?" And he made me correct it.
Well,
and yeah,
that's deep to you. As you were going through the curriculum at school, how much education did you get on the Nazism?
When I was 10 years old, like most of the boys, I became a pimp. That means a Hitler youth,
right,
for 10 years. And I enjoyed it. I was in a drum corps. I had a big drum, and they had those raids, and we went on camp out, we went on hikes, and so it was almost like a Boy Scout affair, but it was politically dominated,
Mm-hmm.
I mean, as a kid, we knew all the ranks from private up to field marshal in the Navy, in the Air Force, Army, or what have you. So, and I remember one thing, I think that was in 1941, though I was about 10 years old, when the school we attended was a Catholic school. It was a boys' school Catholic, and my wife went to the girls' school Catholic, and they were apart, maybe 10 blocks or so. So we used to have the crucifix, and they took it out and put the swastika up there.
Mm.
So that was a blow to us, because, but even the schools were state run, but they were Catholic schools, So then we kind of figured something was going wrong, even as kids.
Now, you had to actually learn a particular oath, didn't you, about Hitler is Germany, Germany is Hitler?
Yeah, but I kind of forget what the wording was. The only thing I remember, and my wife, she knows the same, that, let's say, when the summer vacation started, you know, we had to stand there and sing Deutschland, Deutschland über alles with our hands up, and then a Hauswessellied, another political song, and we were so sick and tired of it, you know, to stand there, and, you know, we had no choice, we had to do it, yeah. So.
As part of the Hitler Youth, did you travel? Did you go to Berlin? Did you go to any of the Nuremberg rallies or anything like that?
No. The only thing I remember, there was a rally, and my dad, like I mentioned before, he was born in Dortmund, which is a war pocket, and they had one big rally there, and we were visiting my uncle and aunt, my brother's father, my father's brother, I'm sorry. And there was a big hill, a main street going up a hill, and that must have been a couple, 3 miles long, going up great, you know. And the march was coming down, and that was in 1938 or 39, before the war it was. The SR, the brown shirts, and SS, all in uniform, and they had torches, carrying torches, and the banners, and that was just very, very impressive for the kid. That's the only parade or so that I remember. We never went to, well, we did go to Berlin, but that was, you know, during the later years when all the bombing was going on, the government tried to protect their cannon fodder, the young kids, the growing generations, and they sent them out of the bombing range. So we were, for 9 months at one time, I was in a camp in Saxonia, and you know, we had a lot of fun. It was different. A lot of snow there, we could do skiing and wandering, and but there again, we had two leaders from the Hitler Youth that were taking care of our political agenda, and then we had one teacher from the hometown that was taking care of the school, the schooling. You know, we were about 30 kids there, all boys.
Baron von Schirach, he was sort of the head of the Hitler Youth.
Baron von Schirach, yeah.
What did you know about him?
Well, the only thing I remember, I mean, was that he was from Vienna. I believe he was an Austrian. Well, not Germany. Hitler took care of that. He was German then, but, well, he was just the leader of the Hitler Youth. Mm-hmm. You see, they had two sections. They had the lower age group that was from 10 to 14, and then the higher one from 14 to 16, and with 16 they started, they all had to go through the Arbeiterdienst, the that was a group, well, it was politically inclined too, that went, for instance, to the marsh area in Germany where they cut chunks of
torf,
but I don't know the English word, what they use for firing, for coal, you know, for they dried it, they cut it in chunks and dried it, and then they use it instead of coal. That and probably building, taking care of things to make pikes or, but it was all, their weapon was a spade. Mm-hmm. And they always had to have a shiny, and unless they used it, you know. a lot of marching, you know, instead of the gun, they were carrying a spade on their shoulder. And then after that, of course, there was the Army, Navy, and Air Force.
As a member of the Hitler Youth, obviously the war starts in 1939,
yeah.
The invasion of Austria. What was the conversation when Hitler started to invade other countries? What was the feeling in the schools?
The first invasion was of Holland, Belgium, France, Luxembourg. That was on May 10th of 1940.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember that well because maybe 4 months prior, that was before Christmas, we had taken in soldiers. You see, the people that were able to, or even barely able to take in a soldier or two that were stationed at a compound in town to, you know, have them sleep there, just like one of the family members, you know, there. We took in two soldiers, and I remember their names. One was Erich Rühmann, and the other one was Franz Hausmann. Nice young fellas, you know, and they all got killed in action, but that was when they were getting ready, the German army was getting ready to invade, you know, France, the Benelux. And on May 9th, you see, I mentioned earlier, we lived about 15 miles at the most from the Dutch border. On May 9th, late in the evening, they started moving out. And we didn't know what was happening until the next day when it was on the radio, you know. There was no TV, you know.
Right.
It was just, we had a little plastic box of Volks Empfänger, or People's Receiver was the name for it, you know. That's what we could hear the news on. Yeah, that I remember. And then going a step farther when Russia was invaded, I remember my father was still home. That was at 41, June 22nd, if I'm correct. That was a Sunday morning. We walked to church where we lived. We had about a mile to walk to church. And my brother and I were ahead of our parents, you know. And then we went down the main street. You know, the church is always in the middle of the town with a road around it all, and then everything, you know, ends up in the church, in the center of town. So we were walking down there, and then people started coming out of the house. Did you hear the last news? Did you hear the news? And no, we just, what happened? The Germany marched into Russia. And I remember in school, we were taken, in history, we were on Napoleon. And when I heard that, I told my brother, Peter was his name, said, Pete, we're going to lose the war. And he got so mad at me, you know, it was pretty...
Because you were studying what happened to Napoleon when he attacked Russia. So that you were studying that at the time, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I, you know, I figured, you know, they're going to lose the war, and they did. I mean, considering the enormous transportation, they had to keep up the forces, the supply them and all that, from the White Sea, from Murmansk down to the Black Sea, 3,000 miles. No, Germany wasn't able to do that.
You mentioned the radio.
Yeah.
The People's Receiver.
Yeah.
When Hitler spoke, did everybody stop and listen?
I mean, he was quite an orator. I mean, he was a talk. And so was little Joe Goebbels.
Goebbels, yeah.
Yeah.
Did you know well in advance that at 8 o'clock there would be a speech by Goebbels or Hitler?
Yeah, that was always very much advertised.
Yeah.
Yeah. They didn't want to miss the people listening to their BS.
Yeah. Were you able to listen to any other radio stations, or was it just
like
one?
Like the BBC?
Yeah.
Yeah, we were able to, but if you got caught, you know, you were in big trouble.
Yeah.
You know, my wife, she knows more about that because I don't think we ever tried it. But maybe we should have. But.
Now, you actually get caught up soon, 1941, the Americans get involved, the Britons get, is obviously, in the war is at hand. And you, as part of the Hitler Youth, sort of get caught up in activities, digging ditches and filling sandbags. And what was your job?
Digging up the dead?
Pardon me?
Digging up the dead?
Well, that was later. No, you mentioned, I'm sorry.
No, about digging ditches and filling sandbags and...
Well, that was in the fall. It started in the fall of 44. That was before the Battle of the Bulge. Because, you know, the Allies were moving closer and closer. And we did dig tank ditches. And I was a leader of a group, I don't know why, but the first thing we had to do, we got a section of the city of Krefeld, which is about 5 kilometers from the town I live, from St. Tunis. And the first thing we had to do was to dig foxholes for ourselves. And sometimes they were used because the fighter planes were strafing, and there was always one fellow, he had to look around to watch the skies if there was something coming or listening, you know, because we were digging. And I forgot the exact dimensions, but it must have been 10, 15 feet wide and about 10 feet deep. Mm. And at the bottom there was a flat of about a foot, and all the dirt was piled up on. But the funny part of it is, I remember one time, and that was right close to the main highway going from town to town, town to city, there came a big truck with some, what we assumed were POWs, that they were. And in front of it was a little German Jeep, and in back of it, and they had a flag on there, but it was a newsreel group that were taking the prisoners back, away from the front. Now, when they saw us, you know, we were looking at them as they were going by. When they saw us, they stopped and moved the whole group back, and then one or two of the fellows came over and said, "Now, why don't you, when we come now with mostly American POWs, because they had the helmet on their head kind of crooked, you know, they were smoking and chewing gum and, you know, like, you know, they weren't afraid of anything. They just, I don't know if I can say that, but they just enjoyed it as much as we did, but they asked us to, when they came by again, to stand there and shake our shovels at them and make noise and, you know, boo them and all that, which we did. But unfortunately, we never had a chance to watch that show on, you know, on a newsreel.
Who knows? We have a lot of newsreel here. Maybe we'll find it someday.
Yeah. That was one answer. And then we also were strafed, and sometimes, you know, the kids, I mean, we were kids, you know, 14 years old, 13, 14 years old, the last school year. And when the alarm came, that the guy that was the lookout, he whistled, blew his whistle, and we all headed for the hole. No matter which hole it was, sometimes you ended up three guys in one hole, you know, trying to not get hit by you.
So you would actually, you'd get the notice and the plane would become, bomber would be coming in, and yeah, they would be shooting.
Yeah, alongside, you know, Phil was right over the ditch.
Wow.
As we were working.
Was there real fear of that, or was it just...
Yeah. I think even some of them got their pants full.
Yeah. I can imagine.
Yeah. I mean, we were just kids, but... We gradually grew into this, so we didn't know any difference.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
As the war was progressing, and you're doing the work of you know, digging the ditches, the tank ditches and stuff, what was your thinking? Did you talk among your Hitler Youth members about how the war was progressing?
Well, in the last few months. I mean, we're still members of the Hitler Youth, but we didn't have any time for hikes anymore or for social gatherings, you know. We just had to work. And one reason, a lot of kids volunteered because we were getting extra rations, food rations.
Mm-hmm.
That was a magnet there for us because things were bad. Well,
and I'm looking over the picture. Your wife pointed out that you actually, a little later on, when the devastation and the bombing occurred, you were put to work to really excavate.
Yeah, we were. We had a walk. There was no transportation, you know, electrical streetcars. They were all out. We had a walk to Krefeld. You know, that I know the... A late fall, there was a bombardment of Krefeld, and one in February of 45. And those two, I remembered, we had to go in. Just us kids and old people, because the rest were serving in the army. We had to go in and try to rescue as much as we could. Clear the rubbish, and sometimes it was too late, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And we could hear people screaming and hollering and so on. Pull the bricks by brick, everything we could, you know, to get there. And sometimes it was too late. Sometimes, most of the times we got through, but that was...
Is that really the time you recognized the real devastation of what the war meant? I mean, it really came home then.
Yeah, it got worse. You see, when the first bombs fell in our town, that was in 41, when the church was hit, or 42. Well, anyhow, some of the bombers, and I read about it, and that sounds, you know, feasible, they didn't get rid of all their bombs. They, you know, and on the way back, somehow, they had to get rid of the bombs before they landed, because it was too dangerous for them to land with a bomb in their belly yet, and so they just got rid of the bomb, and it just happens to one drop right in front of our church, right in the middle of town, and the other one at a convent, which is about a mile, was it a mile difference? Not quite,
yeah.
No, half a mile maybe. And of course, you know, the German propaganda made use of it, that what is it, there were Jewish pilots, you know, they were bombing the church and the convent, which is, you know, nonsense, but
right.
they used it. But there was times that we did, at that time, hate the Americans and the English, because, you know, come 8 o'clock at night, you know, they started flying in. Come 2 o'clock in the morning, they were flying back, or so we always were constantly in our basement. That was our air shelter, air raid shelter. And the last 6 months, we just lived in a basement, because school was suspended. There was no, mm-hmm. you know, and we were working on the tank ditches. And so sometimes we had time to roam the fields and find some undetonated napalm bombs, which we tried to detonate to see how it works. And at one time, we did, and I tell you, they were about this high and this big around, and one was laying right there by the road, and we were four guys from school, and so we tried to, you know, get some stones and try to hit that detonator in front. It didn't work, and then that was right on a T, two roads meeting, and there was a tree on each side of that T, so we picked up that thing and threw it on the road, you know, so that would help. And by the time it came to me, I figured out what they did wrong, the other kids. They didn't throw it so the detonator will hit, you know. And I was lucky enough to make it explode, and it shot up. Then it came down like a fireworks, you know, at Bergman Park there on Labor Day.
Wow.
And we started running for our swimming hole, because I had a drop here and some on my knee, and from the phosphorus. And people working in the field and people driving, bicycling by, they said, "What happened? What happened?" Well, we didn't know, so we just kept on running, you know, to jump in the water to get rid of them. And after we got out a little while, it started burning again, so. But next time in school, we paid for it. We had to bend over, and the teacher let us have it.
Corporal punishment.
Yeah.
Did you at some point leave the area? Did you leave Germany and go to Holland?
During the war?
Yeah.
No.
No.
We did after the war.
After the war. Okay. At one point, at some point, I guess in March, the Americans liberate St. Thomas.
Yeah.
What was that like?
Well,
did you know they were coming?
Yeah. We kept in, you see, the German soldiers were coming back, and I remember one fellow, he had picked up an old baby buggy, and he had all the stuff in there. He had no ammunition. He had nothing to eat. No, mind you, that was in early March. I remember you could see his toe, his boots were all torn up, holes in it. He had to carry his gun, because if he was caught without his gun, you know, the MPs would string him up on the next tree. That happened. And he asked if we had something to eat, so I went up to my mom and asked her, so she made him a couple of sandwiches. And we asked him how much longer before the Americans are coming. Well, he said maybe 2 days at the most, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was the day before they came marching in. So those German soldiers, they just tried to get across the Rhine River and make it home, you know. Some never did. I hope this fellow did, because he seems to be nice. Well, and then I tell you, that was on March 7th. I I always thought it was March 2nd, but that book I was reading there, A Bridge Too Far, confirmed that it must have been March 7th. All of a sudden in the afternoon, now we were reading the leaflets dropped by the planes, and it says to hang a big a white sheet, in, if you surrender, you know, in front of your house, which we did, and stay in the basement, which we did. And there was some shelling. We lived near a factory, so there was some shelling there. And we lived on the west end of town. There was a railroad crossing also. And all of a sudden it stopped. And I know it was around 2 o'clock, so my brother and I and a neighbor kid, Matthew, we got together and we went outside. Also, we were not, allowed, we shouldn't have done that. And across the street from us, across from the house, there was a little playground. Across the street, there was a little vegetable farm. They were growing vegetables for the market and so on. They were hedged all the way around, a big hedge. And then maybe 500, 600 feet from the house, there was the railroad crossing. So we went into the park and looked around, and everything was quiet. And I saw some soldiers in the distance. They were crouching along the hedgerow there. And, from a distance, the helmets were closed. We didn't think they were Americans until they turned around and saw us, And I saw they had those short rifles. What are they called, Tom? M1s?
Yeah, M1, yeah.
Very short with a curved magazine on it. And I said, Pete, they're Amis. We call the Americans Amis for short. They're Amis. And so we ran back home, So they could have mowed us down there because we weren't supposed to be there, mm-hmm. 20 minutes later, they came in the house. They were looking for Nazis. And we lived, we rented an upstairs apartment from the owner. He had a carpenter shop there. And I know he was a party member. Most people in business were party members, just stay in business or what. And his two daughters were. His wife wasn't. Well, so they were looking for Nazis. No Nix Nazis, no Nazis. And then they looked around, and then one of them could speak very good German. And they looked around in the basement, and we usually have our potatoes, our coal bins, a shelf with homemade, vegetables, and what else? Sauerkraut, of course, there was always. they wanted something fresh to eat, and they looked around and they took some jars of fruits, and that was all fine. And then my brother and I, we were kids. We went upstairs, the stairways up, and in the hallway. Well, there was a little shop, as I mentioned before, and what they did, the GIs, they made a little repair station for flat tires or so, because we noticed a lot of those rubber inner tubes laying around. And this one guy, he was an officer, I suppose, because he had a pistol on his. He looked like a cowboy, except he didn't have the head. He just had the helmet on. And he told my brother and I, he said, hey, and he gave us a pump, a hand pump that you pump, you next pump you kaput, you know. And we were scared. So we pumped our heart out and we helped them, you know. And after we were done, they gave us a handful of candies, those square caramels. So they were just pulling our legs.
Yeah, yeah. You didn't know, though.
No, they I'll tell you that. They were good. We, after they marched in, the war was over for us. No more bombing, no more shelling. We didn't have to be afraid to, you know, except for the curfew. We had a curfew from 6 to 6, I believe it was, 6 in the morning to 6 at night. So the war was over for us, and that was on March 7th, 2 months before VE Day, yeah.
Tom told me the story that one time you actually found a crashed Bristol bomber on your way to school one day.
Well, that was Waldschlösschen when, you know, there was a little amusement park for us. The summer days they had a carousel and, you know, slides and so for the kids and people, a beer garden, people in a bowling alley. People would go there on Sundays afternoon. And it was a famous little restaurant, and there again, that's where, what do you say, Bristol bomber? I don't know what kind of bomber it was, but that's where a plane came down. And again, it must have had a bomb left, you know, and then blew up that whole place, you know. And we found one crew member. The tennis court was right across the street there, and there was our swimming hole there and back. So we found one crew member in a tennis court, still strapped to his seat and so, but you know, the whole plane blew up because of the bomb blast. And then it's suspected that one goof fell into the swimming hole, into the pond there. They never found it. And as we were going towards the place to look what happened, we found a crew member laying in a field there, just across the street from it. And our teacher, even though we didn't have any school, but he was the warden, Luftschutz warden. That means he was in charge of things to be done to make sure that people go into the air shelters and so forth. And I think he connected the Red Cross and they got the IDs and you know, took care of it.
Yeah. Shortly after the Americans came, you had to register.
Yeah.
What am I looking at? Tell me what that is.
Well, Zeitweilige Registrierkarte, or temporary registration. And it says my name, Geisler Heinz Albert, my address. And then I had to sign it, and it was signed by a captain. And I had a fingerprint. And the owner of this card is the member of the Sancturnus, the town of Sancturnus, registered is and he cannot leave the place, the town, unless permission by the science officer here.
And you had to carry that at all times?
Yes. Because we didn't have any folio ID or so. Yeah, it's quite battered up. And
as the war ended and there's no longer the threat of strafing and bombing, and what was your reflection? You sat down with your brother and some of your friends and saying, gee, we've just gone through an awful lot here this last 6, 7, 8 years. What was your reaction as a young German teenager?
Well, I tell you, the first few years we were busy to I might say that stay alive to because until 1948, when the D-Mark was established, things were very bad. The food was scarce. We went stealing coal from the coal trains that were designated for Holland, Belgium, and France because reparations, you know, war reparations, and we couldn't see that we couldn't have any coal, and it was all shipped over there. So about 3 miles from our hometown there was a main railroad line, and that's where we were, close to the Ruhrparket. That's where some of the trains were. They had to stop there for some reason or other, and people went climbing up the wagon, you know, the train carts, and threw coal down as much as they could until, you know, they started moving, and then, you know, some people got hurt very bad jumping off moving train. And then after we picked up the coal and took it home, and so we had something to heat in wintertime and to cook on, because all we had was a coal stove or a wood stove, you know, to cook your meal, to cook your water for taking a bath once a week, not once a day, once a week. Friday night was Badetag. Well, but then after, you see, we were turned, also we were taken by the Americans, we were occupied by the Americans. They had their British zone, French zone, Russian zone, I don't know if they had a Canadian zone, but anyhow, we were turned over to the British in late summer of 1945, and we liked the Americans much better than the British, because they, I would say, they were more legere, they were friendly, you know. I never knew what baseball was or pitching horseshoes, but the guys were, you know, where they were stationed in the housing they had, they put their stakes in the ground there. They were pitching horseshoes, and they were playing catch with their big mitts, you know. And they said, So that was all new to us, you know. And, I think, well, there was quite a bit of difference between the English occupation and the American occupation in our area, you know. Like I said before, the Americans were more friendly. They went from house to house to try to get some fresh fruits or fresh eggs and to trade it with cigarettes or chocolate or oranges or bananas or whatever. So
you look over there and there's a picture of the Nuremberg trial.
Yes.
And you mentioned as we were walking in that you actually watched some of that in newsreels.
Yes.
What was your reaction when you actually could now see the head of the German Third Reich in the newsreel? What was your reaction?
Well, I mean, my honest opinion, you know, they had done things wrong and we didn't even know about it. You know, we learned so much after the war on the newsreels, like I mentioned before, about the concentration camp. The only thing what I think was done wrong, to my opinion, that some of the army leaders, Navy, or Air Force, forget about Goering. They were hanged. They were executed by hanging. I think they should have been shot as a soldier. They should have been, you know, executed by a firing squad. That would have been more honorable. Let's face it, I mean, wrong was done on all sides. It's inevitable in a war. It happens now. It happens 200 years before. It will always happen as long as there are wars, and as long as there are people on Earth, I think there will be wars on Earth. So that is the only thing that I personally objected to. But otherwise. It was bad. They done bad things.
Newsreels, how would you see them? Was there a theater in St. Thomas?
Yeah, there was a theater. Yeah, and that was one of the main after the war, even the later times of the war, that except for when the air raids came, you know, then everybody had to go home, but that was quite an entertainment for people movie, before the main movie, always the newsreel started and you could see what was going on in a world that you didn't have a chance before the war. I mean, before we were occupied or liberated, I should say, because we were liberated.
I'm going to soon interview your wife. Did you know her at St. Thomas, even though you had a few years difference? Was she?
No, we lived on the same street. There is now a bypass of the town on the west side. No. Like I said, we had boys' schools and girls' schools, so the boys were kept separate from the girls, and the girls were kept separate from the boys. And it's quite a different arrangement than it is now. And I think it wasn't bad at all. But we never met until 1950, One. 1951, yeah, I don't know. So that was quite a, you know, even so we lived on the same street, but you see, at that time, maybe it's still so, you lived at a, now we lived at the west end of St. Tony's. You had your certain grocery store you went to. You had your butcher. You had your bakery. And that, yeah, mostly those three that you went to, you know, where she lived, maybe half a mile, was it? No. Yeah. Half a mile up the road. She was a different, she was a, what, the eastern part of, or whatever. She had a, her own neighborhood, mm-hmm. you know. And so the only time we could have seen each other, not knowing each other, was in church, you know, when we go to church, because there was one thing. Everybody went to church. And if you didn't wear a hat on Sundays to church, you were a bum.
You're terrific. I really appreciate this.
You do.
He's got a great memory.
Oh, yeah. His is better than mine.
Well, we'll check on that in just a second here. I'm going to change my tape here. So it's the scene is, set the scene where some army troops had some fun with you.
Yeah, but before that I had some fun with some, was it C-ration or K-ration? K-ration, I believe. See, my friend and I, we were walking. See, we lived close to the hometown brewery, and that's where the American logistic company was stationed. They were transporting things across the Rhine River. Now, that was shortly after we were occupied. And a lot of soldiers, American soldiers, were quartered there in the houses. And my friend and I, we were walking to my place. And we found a little box, maybe a foot long, 4 by 2 inches, and we opened it. We couldn't read any English. It said something on there. So we found in there a crackers, a round tin of liverwurst, I believe, a tin of cheese, a 4-pack of Camel cigarettes, a plastic bag of lemon juice, dried lemon, and a little plastic bag of instant coffee. And of all the things, I claimed the coffee for my mother because she didn't have a cup of coffee for years. And when I took it home, you know, she cried for joy to have a cup of coffee, even if it was instant. Well, anyhow, after we knew what was in those green boxes, and we'd seen them before with the Jeep standing around and the half-tonners, they were laying on the floor, on a dashboard, in a bag. It looked like nobody wanted them. But since we found out what was in there, you know, we took some of them. Maybe you call it stealing, but at the time it was not to steal, it was just a find. And one time we got caught. And my friend and I, we started running. There was a freshly plowed field. We figured that would be a safe place, you know. We ran across the field, and we weren't halfway through when we heard a Jeep after us, and and we were taken prisoners by, there was three guys, the driver and two guys with their guns. So they put us in the back seat and got one soldier on each side, you know, with their guns and coming marching down or driving down Main Street. And there was, by the brewery, there was a corner like, and there was a advertising board like you see on the highways. No, there was a straight one.
It was
one.
Straight one, yeah. But it was...
Yeah. So in the meantime, a lot of people were gathered there and a few, I don't know if there was an officer, army officer, but he was a higher up anyhow. They put my friend and I in front of that advertising billboard there. And the two guys with the guns were standing in front of us like there was an execution going on or what, but anyhow. I remember my mother coming, somebody must have told her that Heinz is in trouble. She'd come running up the street and she was crying and clapping her hands. My boy is a good boy, don't shoot him, he's a good boy, and all this. And all, they did have a little fun with us, but we never ever stole a K-ration again. So that, but those were goodies for us.
Yeah.
And the GIs, they just took them in case of emergency. And that's why I mentioned earlier to you, the Camel, the Lucky Strike, Chesterfield, and Old Gold too, they helped win the war.
Did you also get involved with, there was a lot of chocolate, which seemed to be a rare commodity in Germany.
Yeah.
Did Hershey chocolate, was that a known thing?
Oh yeah, then. They had those chocolate bars, and what else? Some other candy bars they had.
I just remember the brown Hershey.
Yeah.
My son-in-law works for Hershey, so I'll use that.
Oh, yeah? Yeah, and coffee was, well, shortly after the occupation, you know, the black market started to bloom. If you had a carton of cigarettes, whether it was Camel, Lucky Strike, or the shorter ones, you could go to a tailor and have yourself a three-piece suit tailored, hand-tailored. It was, you know, that much worth. The Camel, Lucky Strike, and the Chesterfield Old Gold, there was 8 mics apiece on a black market.
One cigarette.
Yeah, one cigarette.
Wow.
Pall Mall, that was longer, was 11 mics. And coffee was high price. What else?
My mother paid 250 marks for a half a pound of butter.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, yeah, just out of curiosity, were the soldiers, was there a lot of, well, here are soldiers being soldiers, was there a lot of conversation about them taking advantage of the Fraulein's of, you know, of the area? I mean, these guys, the war had ended, was there much of that?
There was one woman raped, they claim, in our town.
Yeah. I didn't know.
Yeah, but in St. Tönes, but...
Not a lot.
She did...
What's the time
said
to be
she
late,
liked,
huh?
In, you know, like our sons, they were stationed there, and they married German girls.
No?
Yeah. Yeah. And there was a lot going on legitimate courtship.
Yeah, well... As you can see, these German women are pretty good looking, you know?
But you better not were caught by the Russians.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was one of the stories we heard, disastrous.
Yeah, I worked with a German soldier, you know, he came, he lost his arm, Otto Berger, yeah. And he saw the Russians cut off German women's breasts. They got drunk and
they
mistreated their soldiers like they mistreated the enemies. They didn't have enough ammunition, so they sent hundreds of their people ahead of the regular army, and the Germans were wasting their ammunition on them because the people they sent ahead had no weapons. And then the Germans were out of weapons, and then the army came.
They were out of ammunition.
Yeah. Yeah. So we were very lucky to be on the American side.
Yeah.
I know that because, like I said, my aunt, my mother's half-sister, was taken prisoners. And, you know, then a lot of our relatives came back and told these stories.
Well, thank you again. I'm glad we got that story. You just heard your husband talk about his life. What did he miss? As he was talking about his whole... there's some questions
One thing he said I would know better, and that is about listening to the BBC. We lived in an apartment house. Downstairs was a strong, dedicated party member. But he'd been we lived with my uncle and aunt after the bombing raid. And they've been lifelong friends, good friends. But my uncle listened to the BBC. And he would turn the radio down. I was just a few steps away. I couldn't hear it. And his ear to the radio. So the downstairs good friend wouldn't hear him. You couldn't trust anybody.
Mm-hmm.
You didn't say anything. I remember I must have been 5 or 6 years old. I still see myself standing in that church, but the memory is so active because my mother told the story so many times. But I know I was there. There was a Catholic priest, was a Catholic church, and he said from the pulpit that he didn't burn all the books that Hitler had ordered to be burned. Like Heinrich Heine, a Jewish, beautiful writing he did. And the priest said he didn't burn certain books, but we were standing in back of the church and there was a party member in his uniform. We never saw the priest again.
Mm.
He just disappeared. So you just, as a 7, 8 year old girl, you don't really know what's going on, but you feel the atmosphere. You feel the fear that your parents have and the sadness. My father was drafted 3 months before the war started. He was home on leave sometimes, but he never came back from Siberia.
Now, just hold that for a second. Let me get that. Tell me about your dad. What was he like?
He was a very happy, outgoing person.
Mm-hmm.
Very loving. I felt closer to him than I felt close to my mother.
Mm-hmm.
I remember one time, you know, we would wash on a chair in the kitchen. We didn't have bathrooms. And I had my basin there with water. And I hear a heavy step coming up the stairs. And my father came on leave. I screamed when I saw him. I loved him so much, you know. I just screamed. But the last time I saw him was for my first communion when I was 8 years old. And a while later, he was missing in action. This picture was used to identify my dad. This is my dad. Somebody came home in 48 from Siberia, and he contacted us and wanted to talk to my dad. We said, well, he isn't here. Why isn't he here? He was released in 1947. I said goodbye to him at the entrance of the prison camp. I couldn't leave. He left, but he never made it home. And we thought the man, there was a lot of scams going on because food was so scarce. And we lived in a countryside. We had more to eat than the city. So we sent this picture to the man who said the story. I don't know which one it was. And he identified my father correctly. At about the same time, my mother went to visit her brother in East Berlin. And an official of the Communist Party showed her around, gave her a tour of the good things, supposedly good things, the Russians had done. And my mother has a big mouth, just like me. You are still keeping my husband. 6 months later, from the Swiss Red Cross, we get a notification that my father had died in 1946, which was impossible because somebody correctly identified him to be alive in 1947. Mm-hmm. But that's how the Russians operate. And when he was talking about the difference between the English and the American occupation, the Americans connected more with us. They interacted with us. Mm-hmm. But you have to remember, the English got bombed by the Germans. Right. So they had more animosity against us than the Americans. You know? I remember trading fresh eggs for a candy bar. And another thing, we were, you know, he talked about the curfew. And we would stay behind the gate, but they would come, the Americans would come by, and there was a Negro and a white American. Mm-hmm. And they shook hands with us, and they loved, you could tell they loved children. And my sister was 4 years old. She shook hands with the Negro. We had never seen a Negro.
Yeah.
And she looked at her hand, it turned black.
What did your dad do for a living?
He was a housemeister at a chamber of commerce. You know, take care of the building. What? Maintenance. Okay. And it was government run. It's not like the Chamber of Commerce here.
Mm-hmm.
And he had to be a party member. He also was a member of the SR, not SS, SR.
Mm-hmm. Brown shirt.
Brown shirt, yeah. But I know his heart wasn't in it. As a child like that, it's just the atmosphere between the adults. They can tell. You know, and sometimes the remarks they made about Hitler. I mean, my family, even though my father was there, they just did what they had to do to survive.
Mm-hmm.
But they never really supported it.
What would your mother? Your mother was just a house mother?
Yeah, but no, she was a seamstress, but she did it in the house.
Okay.
And she did war-related work. You had to do, you know, that, like sewing knapsacks. I don't know exactly what she did, but I know she brought home these big stacks of material she had to sew. You know, she had to do.
When you went to school at St. Thomas, you went to the girls' Catholic school. Do you also remember the fact that they kind of remove your crucifix and put up the Nazi symbol?
No, I don't remember that. The first few years I went to school in this city, Krefeld. Okay. And after the bombing, on this date, we moved to St. Ernest. And in this school, I remember religious instructions were not allowed to be taught in school. We met in a convent after school for religious instructions. And then in St. Ernest, I know we had a teacher who was very religious, but she disappeared for a while too.
Mm-hmm. What was the teaching with regards to the Jewish population, the anti-Semitism? What was that about?
Well, I remember my mother talking of all the Jews were rounded up because they were going to be sent back to Jerusalem, to Israel. We didn't know about concentration camps.
Mm-hmm.
The most I found out about concentration camp was at JCC here, when I took History 101 or whatever.
Yeah.
But it upset me so much, and I said, I'll never, ever watch a movie or read about concentration camps. It is horrible. It is beyond my comprehension
mm-hmm.
how people could do that to other people. How can you? But the Russians did the same.
Mm-hmm.
My mother's half-sister, 16 years old, was deported to Siberia and died after 6 months of starvation. She just turned around and died. And I could go on and on about our relatives that perished. What Hitler has done alone to our family is unbelievable. But he did that to everybody.
Mm-hmm. Was there talk around the kitchen table at all? Do you have any recollection of your mom and dad talking about the politics?
Well, my dad left when I was 4 years old.
That's true.
So I don't know. But then we lived with my aunt and uncle, and there were some derogatory remarks, but they didn't really sink in. It's just a feeling of the atmosphere, the scare. You won't say anything loud. You won't say anything outside of these four walls. If you did, you disappeared. You were gone.
You lived there, and there was American bombing while you were there. I mean, do you remember your house being hit?
I can show you a picture of
it. Sure, I'd love to.
We lived about four blocks off that church. But our house wasn't hit.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I can say that, but we were running out of water, so the old man went up the roof and peed on the fire because there was no more water.
Mm-hmm.
But we had water stashed in the basement, and we knocked a hole next door, and my mother soaked blankets in a water pail or basin. And she put me and my sister in a buggy, in a little buggy, and put that blanket over us. And we went through the, you can see how close the building, it's,
right.
The city has now 285,000 inhabitants. It wasn't quite as big then, but it was a big city. And I remember the flames touching. So we walked through the arch of flames. We had the wet blankets, so any funken sparks would turn off. And we went to a park, which was one block away, not 3 minutes. And the morning dew had wet the leaves in the park. So we said, but all around the park, and it was a very rich neighborhood. There was the courthouse and doctors and everything. All around, the park. Let's say the park was maybe 5-6 times as big as this auditorium. Flames, only flames in them. And I was 8 years old, and I never forget in the morning when the flames died down and I saw a little blue sky and I was still alive.
Mm-hmm.
Inside the park, we had to move now and then because they found a bomb that hadn't exploded. You know, there was, like he said, the the air guards, the old men, they would keep watch and kept us, tried to keep us safe.
This would have been what year?
1943. June 22nd, 1943. Two-thirds of the city was destroyed in one night. Mm. But you know what hit me as very odd? There were less people killed than on 9/11 in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there were a lot of people died, you know, but not as many as that one at the World Trade Center. But the city was destroyed, and there was a big steel factory, Stahlwerke, very famous, very productive. Not one bomb hit that factory.
Strategic bombing.
Only the private citizen. I don't know if it was propaganda, but now it strikes me as very logic. The Americans and the English, I mean, the enemies then of Germany, wanted Zermürben, demoralize the population, so we would capitulate, you know, give up.
What was the reaction of your mother after, and the population after all that happened? You look around, you say, "Holy mackerel!" What was your mother's feeling?
Survival.
Yeah.
Survival. The one important thing was how to survive. You only do what you had to do to survive.
Mm-hmm.
No luxuries. Just survival. That's why we appreciate so much what we have today here. My husband always says, especially the time after the war when we had nothing to eat, go in a grocery store, there is nothing, nothing on the shelf. Maybe they had a pound of butter under they were hiding for their special customers. But go into Wegmans and it's empty. You can't imagine. We had nothing to eat. So you did what you had to do.
Now, the family at the time consisted of your mother and your younger sister.
Yeah.
And you.
Yeah.
Did you have any correspondence with your father? Did you know where he was?
Yeah, all through the war until shortly after this happened. He came home once more on leave because emergency leave to help us. But in 1944, he was missing in action. And my mother was just skin and bones. She, every day waiting. You see, he died. He didn't die in one moment. He died over years and years. Every day, he died again. And my mother was a seamstress, so she would go to the farmers and sew clothes for them and then came home with food, mm-hmm. you know. So we were off a little bit better. But still I got TB and my sister and I, we had horrendous pinworms because you couldn't even get soap, you know. And one time I got all these yellow boils over my body. we had all these terrible things happen, but the human spirit is great, you know. They survive.
At some point, the Americans, as your husband talked about, entered St. Thomas.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Oh, yeah.
What do you remember?
Never forget. I sat in a white children's bed in the basement. The potato bin was there, the coal bin over there, the shelves with the homemade canned goods on this side. And here was I, 10 years old, and my sister was 4. And these little kids sitting there in that little baby bed, shaking their boots off, you know, lifting their arms. And when I think back now, they probably thought, what a sorry lot, you know. I mean, but to us it was real. They had the guns drawn, you know. And
now in your house was, now you lived in an apartment, right?
Yeah.
Was your Nazi party owner, was he still there?
Yeah, he was in that, and he wasn't a Nazi anymore, if you ask him. Yeah. Nobody was a Nazi anymore. I mean, they're still hunting them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How did they treat you? How did the Americans treat you?
I felt comfortable with them. We would go outside when, you know, when curfew was over and talk to them, ask for candy bars. And I saw an orange. I didn't know what an orange was. And I see this soldier playing with it, you know. I was dying for that, but I didn't get the orange. I did get some candy bars, and we felt comfortable mm-hmm. with them, you know. Americans are very, very friendly, outgoing, open. Yeah. English people aren't like that, you know. German people aren't like that.
Mm-hmm.
Germany is so overpopulated, you have to protect your little living space, you know. But then, and when it was so bad that we didn't have any food, you had to protect your food there too. I know my mother had once company from a good friend, and when she left, our ration mark stamps were gone. She stole, like he said, he stole coal.
What were the rations? What was it? Do you have a weekly coupon that you could get?
I think they were monthly.
Monthly, but they were weekly.
Divided into weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And you could, an achtel, 2 ounces of lard. If you got those, you were lucky. 2 ounces. Can you imagine? 62.8 grams.
Yeah.
2 ounces. I never forget that.
Wow. When the war is over, you would have been 10 years old.
Yeah.
What was, you know, he talked a little bit about St. Thomas, the area, and you saw the pictures. How long did it take to sort of get back to normal, if there was normal?
Well, this is Krefeld.
Okay,
at that time we lived in St. Thomas, and only the convent and the church was hit,
okay.
Which wasn't important to your physical health, your mental health. And they did have a building that they converted into a church next to the hospital. I don't know.
Aloysius,
a home where you meet for things, and they converted it into a church. And it really was built up rather quickly. The church and the convent was even better than before. It was rebuilt better. And, you know, children are resilient.
Mm-hmm.
So we made it, except for the smell, out of my clothes. My mother washed and washed and washed, and that smoke smell, she couldn't get out of the clothes.
Phosphor was bad too.
Phosphor, yeah. But I always felt safe if I had my mother close by. Mm-hmm. You know, so she was there and I was happy.
You talked about your mother, and your mother longed for and expected someday to actually see your dad, her husband,
yes,
to come home.
Yes, yes.
Was there some moment where there was resignation that said...
Not by the time I left Germany. And then sometime, I don't know when it was, there was, I think 20 years after the war, that there was still some coming home, and we had hope again. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't happen at a certain point. Like I said, it happens a little bit every day. Mm-hmm. Now, he had a cousin?
A grand uncle.
How many years was he in?
That was during World War I. He was taken prisoner in Russia, and he was in Siberia, and he came home in...
19 years later.
Early 30s. He escaped the camp, walked through China, into Japan, and hired on as a coal trimmer on a ship to Hamburg. That's where he was originally from.
But he never was the same. He just would sit in his garden and...
just look around at the birds.
And talk.
At the greens, at the trees. Smoke his pipe.
When you would watch the newsreels, and you saw, again, those people who you just heard the names of, but now you can see the pictures of Goering and Hitler.
Well, at 10 years old, you don't go to them. Your mother doesn't let you go to the movies.
Okay.
So I didn't see any of those. But I mean, we saw plenty of pictures in the newspapers even before, while the war was still going on.
Mm-hmm.
And we had so much animosity against these people, disdain, and I won't call it hatred because you don't hate somebody on the picture.
Yeah.
But then after he destroyed, I mean, I could go on and on about my relatives that perished in the war. You don't know how you deal with that sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Is it hard for you to talk about it?
Yes, it brings it back. Mm-hmm. The hardest time I had, like I said before, is when I took that course at JCC. What they were teaching there, I lived through. And I know I had psychology class after, and we did an experiment, and my temperature had dropped 10 degrees. You know, we did something with temperatures, and I said, I'll never, never, ever look at something like that again. And here I am, I'm reliving it, mm-hmm. You know. And these certain pictures, like me in that back of that church with that Nazi standing there, or that first blue sky after the bombing raid, they never leave you, never. And we were here 30 years. You know how it's customary here, you go to a funeral home to visit a dead person? He would not go. He said always, I've seen enough dead people to last me a lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
And that from a 13-year-old boy. It's horrible. I don't really want anybody to hear about this.
Though, isn't it important to have your Tom to hear about this and his kids to kind of know what mom and dad were about?
We talk about it, you know, mm-hmm. but not so in depth as I'm doing it now. Mm-hmm. I'm reliving it now.
Mm-hmm. You're amazing. Both of you are amazing. And I suppose we need to talk a little bit about how you met here in the United States. You're both from St. Tonus. You spent time together, lived on the same street, even though...
We didn't meet here.
Oh, you didn't meet here.
We were married.
Okay.
Before we came. And this is a happy thing to talk about. Like I said, my mother was a seamstress. And in Germany, when somebody has a golden wedding anniversary, their whole town celebrates. They rent a big dance hall, and all the proceeds go to the anniversary couple. And my mother had sewn all the dresses for the bride, not bridal party, the anniversary party, you know. So I got a free ticket, and she got two free tickets, but she wouldn't go. Later on, she said, but when I met him there, I should have gone and kept you away from him. But I took my girlfriend, and I had one dance with him, and I was in love. I was 16 years old, and we courted for 5 years. And then when I was 21, in May, in June we got married because my mother wouldn't sign the papers. And his aunt and uncle from Ripley attended the wedding. And that's when we got, but I was pregnant for 7 months when we got our papers. And in Frankfurt, the American consulate separated us. And I had to swear that he could leave without me. They did not want to be the cause of a family being torn apart. And made sure that I was, everything was on the up and up. So the baby was born in December 28th, and I left Germany June 17. And I remember June 17 so well because that is when there was an uprising in Berlin. And Russian tanks, in 56 was the uprising.
No, that was in Hungary, 53, I believe.
53, and in Hungary in 56. Yeah. And, that's why I remember the date when I left, and I arrived on the 25th with my 6-month-old son. He's back in Germany, and one of our other sons live in Germany now. And that's our story.
Tom, what are we missing here?
The Iron Cross.
Yes.
Yeah,
Arnold's Iron Cross.
That was his.
He had two Iron Crosses.
He had two. Cross. We only have one. I don't know what happened to the other one.
Now, whose cross is this?
My father's.
Your father's, okay.
Yeah.
And how did he get it?
Yeah. He repaired a telephone line between two Russian tanks, and they didn't know he was crawling between them. Mm-hmm. And that's why he got it. That's it. I don't know why he got the other one.
That's clear.
Yeah.
One of the things is just, what's your memory of your dad? I mean, I know you talked about the story coming up in your song, but...
We were very close. My mother was a clean freak. Mm-hmm. And I remember once, I was a slob. I mean, there was a mud puddle and I wouldn't miss it, you know. One time I got my shoes all muddy and my father said, come on, let me wash those shoes before she upstairs gets a coronary. And that was our relationship. Yeah. And when my mother got pregnant with my sister, she had already two miscarriages. So she had to be taken care of, and my father got off for a while from the war. And he would come almost home almost every night. We don't know where he got it, because food already was starting to get scarce. He would say, "Which hand?" And he would bring us something. It just was wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Christmas was very special for him. I remember how he was excited, like more excited than I was, you know, to make other people happy. He was a good athlete. When I was last time in St. Tönis, his picture was still hanging in that restaurant. They had restaurants where they met the athletic clubs, you know, and his picture was still hanging there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Any question I should be asking her? What have we missed?
Not much, huh? Well.
She said it was love at first sight. What do you say?
It was. Yeah, I was out with the guys, a group of five.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you were done for, huh?
Yeah. Well, that's the way it goes, I guess.
It happens to all the great men here. But I can't thank you enough. This has been a magic and obvious. I will make copies of this for...
Well, it really feels good to let people know about it. You know, I think our side.
When I seen Hermann Göring, he was not one of my favorite. There was a joke going around that might be of interest to you. There was this fish guy running around with a car selling fish, you know. And then he was advertising, he pulled up and said, herring, as big as Hermann Göring. The cops got him, you know, he was in jail for 2 weeks, you know. Then they let him out again, and he on the market again on this car that said, herring, as big as 2 weeks ago. Well, they couldn't get him on that one. I remember that as a kid. He didn't make jokes about him. But I remember you asked that about the Jewish people. I remember at Kristallnacht, you know what I'm talking
mm-hmm.
about.
Mm-hmm.
That was St. Martin. St. Martin is a Catholic saint.
Big holiday in Germany.
Yeah, and the school, we make our...
Lanterns,
you know, all homemade. And then we have a big march around town with St. Martin on the white horse and the beggar. And then we go to school after that and get a big bag of goodies and a Wegmann.
And that was Kristallnacht.
Yeah, and on my way home, I went by that church that we mentioned earlier that was...
The Nordkirche, yeah.
To go home, and across from that home that became the church after the bombing was the synagogue.
Mm.
And as I was walking around, it was on fire, and there were people standing around, and the fire department was, putting the flames out. And I going home and tell my parents about it, and then the next morning, that was when the Nazis raided all the Jewish stores. We had a clothing store, a furniture store, different other stores, and they had ransacked the stores, you know, and busted the windows. Windows, and the funny part of it is that people, they had to open the safe and spread everything around. The funny part of it is I heard from old timers that some of the names they had bought a suit on Time by Bloomberg. That was a Jewish clothing store there. So they, you know, they were Nazi members. They were party members that had done so. Yeah,
the first Middle East War, Abu Dhabi and Kuwait. We had two sons there, one Marine and one Navy. The Navy was a helicopter pilot, and they started a support group here. And I went to one meeting, and there was a mother with a little girl. She was about 7 years old, and her father was there too. I sat there, and I just started to cry because I knew what that little girl was going through. I said, I don't need that. I'm never going to another meeting. And I didn't. But we had two sons there. I would get up at 2 o'clock in the morning and watch the television with Wolf Blitzer. I felt a connection to my son, you know. Sometimes he said when they got leave, they would rent a hotel room with 25 guys just to use that telephone, and he would call me at work here sometimes. It wasn't then the cell phones and all these things that you have now and computers, you know, but I relived what I knew what that little girl was going through. And my heart just went out to her. And I usually don't cry easy. I don't cry easy. You know that, Tom, don't you?
Oh, yes.
Well, again, thank you. This has been just terrific. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having us.